I'm Bridget Green.
And I'm Cavin Weber.
And today we're bringing up the AMD Ryzen 5000 series desktop processors.
And a super special little project.
So good to have you here, finally.
I heard you want to talk about technology. You don't have to twist my arm too hard on that topic.
I have hot gossip.
Are you looking for secrets?
Bring up. Bridget. She's dead. You may not like it, but this is what peak performance looks like.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to The Bring Up. Cavin, how does it feel being back on our beloved set and not in your kitchen this time?
It feels very good. There's so much space for activities, and I've been having a lot of fun here working on our super special little project.
Oh, yes. Well, before we go into everything Cavin's been working on, I wanted to lay a little bit of groundwork because since our last episode, there's been not one, but two huge product launch events here at AMD. Of course, one being the AMD Ryzen 5000 series desktop processors, which are now available. And then also the AMD Radeon RX 6000 series graphics cards, which will be rolling out over the next few weeks. So Cavin and I actually got to be on site supporting the filming and production for both of those events. So we got to see it live, baby. And after all of that product launching, I can say I think we are sufficiently hyped to talk to you guys today.
Yes, we're going to be deep diving into Ryzen 5000 series. And so, of course, we need to have our very special friend on the show, Dr. Robert Hallock.
Yeah, a little bit later, we'll have Robert on to talk through some of the top things you should know if this is your first time with a Ryzen processor, or maybe it's your first CPU ever. But before we do that, I think that now is the time, Cavin, for you to debut your masterpiece.
Yeah, so when I first found out that we were going to be doing another huge double launch on both the graphics side and the processor side, after my panic attack, I realized that we need to be the first ones to build a computer featuring the Radeon RX 6000 series and Ryzen 5000 series.
Well, Cavin, to be fair, I think the engineers were probably the first ones to have both of those in a computer.
Okay, well, theirs isn't going to be as cool.
Well, you might be right about that. Let's roll that beautiful build footage.
It's not every day that we get two awesome launches like this back to back, so it only makes sense for us to take this opportunity to build a PC that's worthy of these two incredible parts. Today, we're going to be using the AMD Ryzen 9 5900X and the Radeon RX 6800 XT, both of which are the second highest performance parts in their respective stacks. The 5900X is the best gaming processor on the market right now, and it's a no-brainer if you want to get the most you possibly can out of your games. The Radeon RX 6800 XT is purpose-built for 4K gaming at maximum graphics, and I actually really like the way this looks. It's got that like chunky, brutalist aesthetic, and it's built like a tank, but it's actually surprisingly light. And then, of course, we have this gorgeous case with a custom vinyl wrap to house it all in, designed by our very own Dylan Nelson in our creative studio. Now, I have a special secret surprise in store for the end of this build, so make sure you don't miss that. But we've got a lot of work to do, so let's get started. I chose these parts for their looks and their personality. We're starting out with an X570 motherboard and 64 gigabytes of DDR4 memory. The primary storage in the system is going to be this PCIe Gen 4 M.2 SSD, which will take advantage of this processor's many lanes. I've had the chance to use one of these already, and I can tell you they are truly stupidly fast. This case comes with a hard drive cage. It's adorable. We're not going to use that. And on that same note, the motherboard came with SATA cables. There aren't going to be any SATA cables. Can we get a camera on here? Because I don't understand what I'm looking at. This is a front panel header. That's just like one thing that you just plug in. Is that something we could have been doing this whole time? All right, now we're all done. It was a pretty standard build, all things considered, other than a few little fancy touches here and there. I'm really happy with the way it turned out, but there's one thing that's bothering me a little bit. They have this big, beautiful backplate on the GPU here. It is very handsome, but it just seems like an awful lot of real estate to go unused. So I'm gonna give it a little zhuzh. Specifically, I added this. It's a little GUI that shows your critical system temperatures and activity. Some of you may recognize in the center here is a little Conway's Game of Life running. The higher your GPU load, the more activity you'll see in this part. I did this by mounting a Pico projector in the case that's displaying a program I wrote to read the system values and projection map them onto the back of the card. And if you don't feel like looking at your system stats, you can also just play some cool motion graphics on there. Kind of makes me feel like RGB builds are just a little lackluster in comparison. I am very much looking forward to taking this home and enjoying it properly, at least until my boss notices. If any of you are interested in this build or my little lighting project, please let us know down in the comments, and we will maybe feature it in a future episode. And now that I finally have a build that might make Robert Hallock jealous, let's go have a chat with him.
We are joined by Director of Technical Marketing and very cool person who we like a lot, Robert Hallock, to talk about something we've been waiting to talk about all year, maybe even longer at this point, which is the AMD Ryzen 5000 series desktop processors. So
here
Robert,
at last.
Thank you for joining us.
Hey, thanks for having me. Really excited.
Why are we jonesing so hard to talk about this? What is so special about these processors?
Two things for me. One, I know that I have the fastest gaming CPU in the world, and I've known that for about 6 months, and I really want to talk about it in detail, because that's a big moment for AMD and for all of us working on Ryzen. The other thing that I'm really excited to talk about is sort of the nuts and bolts of how the Ryzen 5000 series works. And by that, I mean, when you open a monitoring tool, which I do, other power users do all the time, you're going to see things that are different from the CPU that you may be upgrading from.
So your architecture may be changing. There's going to be a lot of new, maybe scary things happening, but we're here to walk you through the process.
We're here to walk you through it. To your point, Cavin, let's take maybe a user upgrading from 3 to 5 years ago. Not uncommon as an upgrade cycle. If they come to the Ryzen 5000 series, they've got a new architecture that's exclusive to AMD. Nobody's seen it before. They've got a 7-nanometer process technology that they've never encountered before. Looks very different from whatever they might have. Functions differently from whatever they might have. They've got a new motherboard and chipset. They've got a new software stack. They have different firmware on the CPU controlling power, consumption, sleep, voltages, temperatures. That's a lot of change.
Well, yeah, let's de-scary this process for people a little bit and just break it down into a few key things they should be on the lookout for.
Okay, let's do it.
So let's start with a fun first one, which is, what if I wanted to overclock my CPU?
Ah, overclocking. Okay, so that's one of the big things that is different on Ryzen. When you spend time overclocking your computer, there is an amount of tinkering and experimentation that goes along with it to just dial it in perfectly. And anybody who spent time overclocking knows that. On Ryzen, if you're going to spend the time to do that, the best use of your time is overclocking the RAM, which in turn affects the speed of our Infinity Fabric. And the Infinity Fabric is an on-chip, it's actually on the CPU, that connects different pieces of the chip together. So the faster you make that fabric go, the faster the CPU goes. And that's controlled by RAM speed. So if you're going to spend time overclocking, which I cannot officially recommend that you do because it's not supported by your warranty, but you're gonna do it anyways. So if you do, your time should be spent on overclocking RAM and therefore the fabric that will give you the best performance return for your time.
So talking about overclocking, one of the things we have to do is monitor your voltages and your temperatures. I know, you know, way back in the day, if it was an 8350 FX processor or something, those temperature limits are going to be completely radically different than any of the new Ryzen Zen based architecture processors.
For sure.
So what is a safe voltage or a safe temperature, or what are the ranges we should be looking for?
That's a really nuanced question, and people mean different things when they ask that question. So I'll start from the simplest. If you just plug in this CPU and you're using it, what is normal? What are you going to see on a regular basis? So starting with temperature, it depends on the CPU, but the processors in the Ryzen 5000 series are designed to have a maximum temperature of 90 or 95 degrees Celsius.
It's pretty toasty.
Historically, that might be. For other process technologies, and other chip designs that might have been toasty. But as process technologies evolve and as processors get smaller and more dense and faster, a parallel effort is also to make them more tolerant. Colder is better. You know, you're going to get more performance out of that because our boost can actually improve for you if you have colder temperatures. But you know, there's nothing wrong or bad about running at 90 to 95 C. And on the topic of voltage, the processor itself is designed to use anywhere between 0.2 and 1.5 volts. That is presuming the core is active and in use and it's doing something. Because if it's not, it's actually asleep using 0 volts. But if the core is awake, you should expect to see 0.2 to 1.5, somewhere within that range. If you have fewer threads running, like maybe you're running a game or handling background tasks or just light desktop work, the voltages will be a little higher because you're only running a couple cores and you can get them to a very high frequency. But if you're running an all-core workload, call it full load, maybe more like 1.3 or 1.35 would be normal. You know, your processor is not a fixed voltage all the time. It fluctuates up and down as your load changes. So you have to think about what is the average over 12 hours or 24 hours as I use this CPU. And these excursions down to 0.2 or up to 0.5, you know, they average out in a big way. And that could mean maybe your 24-hour average is 1 volt or 1.2. So keep time in mind. My takeaway is, and what I've had to come to terms to with in the Ryzen era, being a user who runs these monitoring tools, is the idea of just go in peace. That the processor is incredibly smart. It knows on a millisecond to millisecond basis what is typical and what is right for the workload. Because, God, Ryzen is incredibly sophisticated and fast compared to what users may be accustomed to. And like I said, that might be jarring, but I view it as an exciting opportunity to learn something new about an entirely new set of technologies.
So let it go. Live, laugh, love. Let Ryzen take the wheel.
Yeah. I mean, you could put those up as nice wood-burned plaques in your house.
In your house. Yes.
Yeah.
Want to have you talk through, in a nutshell, what is AMD Boost?
Oh, great question. Yeah, so processor boost, let's just start there. And it's not AMD FX Boost or AMD Ryzen Boost, just boost as an idea in general. All microprocessors have it these days. But there is something very different about Precision Boost 2 that separates it from its contemporaries from other vendors. And ours is truly adaptive. It is not, I'm running 4 threads, so I get this clock speed, right? It's not a direct A-B relationship. Because if you set an A-B relationship, you have to do that based on the lowest common denominator or the worst case. So what about all those other workloads that are better than the worst case? They don't get all the performance that they deserve. So we built Precision Boost 2 with a really, really smart algorithm that every 1 millisecond is asking questions like, am I at the highest temperature? No. Am I consuming too much power from the CPU socket? No. Am I using the voltage regulators on the motherboard too hard? No. How many threads do I have running? How intense are those threads? And if it sees that there's headroom in any one of those categories, we raise the frequency. And we keep doing that. You know, raise the frequency until you reach the maximum frequency of the CPU, or keep the boost duration longer and longer and longer and longer until one of those limits is encountered. And that is one of the major ways why Ryzen is able to give so much performance out of the box, because the boost technology can adapt on a millisecond to millisecond timescale to every workload you throw at it, and give the highest possible clock speed for the circumstances that the processor sees. And we hope that you will like the performance. It's truly, truly fast. I can't wait to get my upgrade. I get it fairly soon here. But you know, in general.
Wait, Cavin beat you?
He did.
I got one before you did.
Yeah, you did.
Oh, finally, OMG. Exciting.
I'm never going to hear the end of this.
If you like being able to monitor your system temperatures, I think you're really, really going to like the new build I just made. I don't think you've seen it yet, but I will send you some videos, and then later I will get to see how jealous you are.
Yeah, well, you know, 6 feet distance, so just leave your computer with me, and I'll take good care of it. But, you know, I guess the key takeaway after these questions is truly new processors do not come along all that often. It is a unique opportunity, and they're just so fast. They're so fast, like 25% upgrade in the same socket in terms of performance. It's crazy. So, hey, guys, everyone out there, enjoy the Ryzen 5000 series. And if you ever have any questions, I am on Reddit at AMD_Robert, or email me or whatever. I'm on Discord. We'll talk about it. I love chatting about this technology. You can find me. I'm out there.
It's a pleasure, as always, to have you on, Robert, and I hope we can do it again soon sometime.
Yeah, me too. This is always fun. Thanks, guys.
Well, Cavin, we have a rad new system. We talked to our good friend, Robert. I would say this episode is one for the books. But there is one thing that I've been wondering, which is, how did you get that little teeny projector mounted?
Yeah, so it's actually pretty cool. I took a volumetric scan of all the parts in the case, and then I created a custom 3D printed mount that just sort of fits in there really securely.
Cavin, you glued it, didn't you?
I did. I did glue it in there, yeah. If you enjoyed this episode, then by all means, hit that subscribe button and click the bell icon so you never miss a future very interesting episode.
Thank you guys, as always, for watching. We have a little treat for those of you who stuck around to the end of the episode, and we'll see you next time.
Les Loups Rouges, as it would come to be called, borrows inspiration from a variety of architectural and artistic sources. From the subtle crenellations on the RAM modules alluding to the Persepolis Palace steps, to the vibrant red motif carried through the piece acting as a cheeky nod to the famous painting Open Window Coyure. Perhaps more directly, the piece as a whole is intended to be an homage to Vermeer's Girl with a Pearl Earring. While on its own, the connection might not be immediately apparent, when the two images are overlaid, the connection becomes clear. Les Loups Rouges will be on display for public viewing in the National Gallery of London until December 1st.